That is the most important thing. As long as I ate, and as long as I had clothes, and as long as I had a place to stay, that was the most important thing to her. She was never able to emotionally nurture me. So that left some sort of self-hate for myself because I felt like I wasn't enough, you know, for a certain amount of time.
There was like a shift in his behavior, a shift in his personality. At the age of 10, he just started wilding out.
He would like act up in school, you know, class disruption, fights a lot. I stayed on him 24/7 and we would bump heads and we did not get along. When he was 13, we got him evaluated and they told me that he was bipolar. They wanted me to put him on medication and I refused because where I'm from, we don't label kids. And I don't really believe in, you know, dosing kids up with drugs or anything like that. I would prefer going through counseling and trying to get to the root of the problem. And we did that. It just got really, really bad. He was able to get kicked out of every school in our district, which is why he ended up living with my mom.
Go and take the picture while I tell you. You play so much, man.
My mom, she lives like right across the street from the hood. And he just made his way over there. And he enjoyed it. He started skipping school. At the time, he would always say, I want to be a rapper. And so as an incentive, I offered to, you don't have to get straight A's. Just stay in school, don't get in any problems. And I would have him go to the studio on the weekends.
He's showing signs of corruption that went from something to nothing. Put his hands on his mother and now he's fucking his cousin. Now she's happy.
I remember him making his like first song at like 14 and we were like, yo. Like we didn't expect that at all. It was like almost like he was telling a whole story. That was like the first time we heard him like curse too.
It was very inappropriate, but I was like, all right, you got something. I kept up my end of the bargain until it didn't work anymore. He was caught up in a few home invasions. He was caught selling drugs. He was caught with a gun. He had all types of charges.
Is it rolling?
Yeah, I'm just gonna roll.
All right. Hi, my name is XXX.
My name is Ski Mask, the Slump.
God, I have a skinny dick.
I don't know what you're talking about. I didn't know what to make of Jose at first. I met him in juvenile jail. I was at least 16. I think he was younger than me at the time. He told me his charges, and I was like, this nigga's in here for armed robbery? for home invasions? I'm like, okay. What really connected us was we would be beatbox, like making beats on the table, on the chairs and shit, and we would just be freestyling. We would just like feed off of each other. We both were the big brother and little brother at the same time to each other. We didn't even know what we wanted to do at the time. We just know we wanted to make a stand for who we are and just be ourselves, say fuck it, like no matter the consequences. At that point, we were like, we don't really want a job. And if we need a job and the job doesn't want us because we have face tats, then that's not the job we would really want for ourselves or some shit. Like, fuck it, this is what we're doing.
Real piece of shit.
Dirty piece of shit.
Back then, we were stealing shit. Well, I was. I was stealing cough syrup and selling it. We were just having a lot of jugs, really, back then. And we found a lot of ways to make money, but because our parents wasn't helping us with nothing, really, because they just thought we were fucking horrible kids at the time. I remember Cleo's mom picking me and Jose up one day, and this is the first time I meet the lady. And she says, why are you hanging out with him? He's a bad kid. This is what she tells me. He's a bad kid. Why are you chilling with this boy? I feel like a lot of times Jose did feel like even his family didn't really like him at that point. He didn't understand how his family treated him. Like he was just this bad child. But if you think in Ja's mind back then, Ja didn't think that he was just this bad child trying to rebel. Ja thinks he's just being Ja. You know what I mean? Like, I'm just being me, and niggas hate me. And I hate myself because niggas hate me, and I need to change myself, basically. I've seen him literally choose to sleep on the streets more times than go home. He didn't explain it to me all the time, but I just knew he even felt better sleeping with me in the car.
When he left home. Nobody kicked him out. And it was as a result of him not wanting to follow the rules or not follow curfew or just doing whatever he wanted to do.
And then he just stopped going to school. He just was like, yo, I'm good.
I don't even know why we wanted a group at the time, but I was like, nah, we gotta make a group of some kind. And I was like, very rare. And me and Ja rode that shit out till the wheels fell off. And then out of nowhere, Ja wanted to make his own group too. And that was Members Only.
Ja used to always be like, I'm about to start this shit called Members Only, bro. There was really no like planned creation. It was kind of just like a manifestation type of thing for him, you know? And it was kind of like a brotherhood.
Mostly everybody would come to my house. We had a backyard, and we would just like sit back there and smoke and write lyrics and listen to Mad Instrumentals. Slapbox.
Ja ordered a snowball microphone, like one of the cheapest microphones you could get, and we just started recording on it. We were recording in bedrooms. My friend's bedroom, friend's closet. It doesn't matter what it was. He would pull that little thing out with the three prongs, and we would just record that shit. And that's why our music came with distortion, because the type of mic that we were using, but we would use it to our advantage, really.
It was like the SoundCloud era of rap. We didn't know what we was doing.
People loved the first song that Ja dropped on his SoundCloud. It was Vice City.
What really had us notice, what really like rang bells where we're from, was the shows.
Ja always had this aura about him that he was not gonna let us not be accepted.
I'm not gonna run this bitch until y'all come up.
We would pull up 60, 70 deep, and we're gonna grab everybody else off the walls.
So he always had a huge crowd of people around him, and then everybody looking at it like, what the fuck is this, or who is he?
No, real shit. I appreciate all y'all for coming out here. Yeah. Even if you didn't come out here for me, man, but all the support and all y'all, man.
He had a way of making people feel wanted, needed, important, and that's what would gravitate them towards him.
He was so comfortable showing his vulnerability. It kind of made kids relate to him.
They reach out to him and say, bro, you saved my life.
Being imaginative and really thoroughly like studying the dictionary and thesaurus, and I really started liking making music, and then I started using it to kind of cope and as an antidepressant. I found a new comfortability within myself when I recorded music.